Afternoon, that breathtaking action from last year's transatlantic challenge here at Donington, but believe you me, that could be child's play compared to what's in store for us over the next 3 days in the 86 challenge, the 16th annual battle between Britain and the USA. Why do I say that? Well, the changeable weather for one thing, but for another, since Britain won it last year to make it 10-5 to them overall, the Americans decided to send over their young breed of bike riders, all of them hungry for revenge. On top of that, they'll be competing over a new-look Donington circuit, which has been extended during the winter, to include a new half-mile loop with two hairpin corners between Coppice and Redgate, where we're sitting now. Two new captains on view as well this year. For Britain, Rob McElhenney from Humberside. He'll be on a genuine American superbike, the one ridden by Eddie Lawson, which won the Daytona 200 3 weeks ago. And I'd like you to meet his oppo from California, the 23-year-old Fred Merkel. Quite a character he is. He fits in his racing between TV commercials and male modelling, would you believe it's now. And hear from the two captains who will be leading their teams into action. They're talking to Gary Newborn.
Fred Merkel, what do you say to the criticism that nobody's heard of any of you American riders over here?
Well, it is true. It's the first time for all of us to come over here, except for one of the riders, I think. But not much. It's a little tough for us coming to a new racetrack in a different country and trying to learn a racetrack, and some of us are riding bikes we've never seen before, so it's a little bit tough on us, but we're making okay.
Have the Americans sent their best possible team?
I think so. At this time, I do, and their equipment is up to standards, up to par, and I think we can do a good job.
Okay, Ron, you seem to be the only rider, Rob, who is riding an American-type machine. What sort of disadvantage is the British team going to have then?
Well, nothing really, because the bikes they are riding, they are quite competitive against the American team and my bike. They've rode them all last year. They've just updated the engines a bit, so they're quite competitive. So we've got a very strong team.
How much are you going to miss Ron Haslam? He only rides if it's wet.
Quite a lot. I mean, we was counting on Ron. The Suzuki deal fell through, which we was looking forward to, but... Ron's going to be, I think most of the races could be in the rain, unfortunately, so Ron will be there.
18 races are just 7 laps, the front row of the grid. The big surprise, the sensation, Kenny Irons, the British boy, the Luton rider, is in pole position, 23 years of age. Kenny Irons on the farthest away from us on the grid. A tremendous performance from Kenny Irons on the Yamaha. There you can see Kenny with the KI on his crash helmet. A talented young man. Next to him is the American Kevin Schwantz. In third position is Steve Parrish Stavros on the Loctite Yamaha. Then Fred Merkel on the factory Honda. Then number 55, Paul Idden, one of the new boys in the Skull Bandit Suzuki squad. Then on the second row of the grid is Rob McElhenney with the Yamaha that Eddie Lawson raced in Daytona. Next to him, the French Canadian, and away they go. And it's Kenny Irons who makes the start. Equal machines, a real massive ride, is going into Redgate for the first time. Number 8 on the right-hand side of your screen should make the lead. No, it's not. Kevin Schwantz, the Texan, the blonde, curly-haired young Texan on a Suzuki he'd never seen before till he got here. Kevin Schwantz is the leader. Kenny Irons is in second place. So America leads in this first race, just 7 laps. If you make a bad start, you're in serious trouble. Schwantz the leader, Kenny Irons in second place, and the pack still very close together as they go through Craner Curves, Hollywood's underneath Starkey's Bridge for the first time.
And Stavros, Steve Parrish is up onto third place with Rob McElhenney, the British team captain, in sixth place on the Mulberry Yamaha.
This is Kevin Schwantz, the man in your picture. He's got an appointment in Italy next week after the match races to talk to the Kajiva people. There is Kenny Irons, there's Steve Parrish, then Rob McElday, then Roger Bennett. Oh, and Roger Marshall had to pick the bike up there, and he was in trouble. And the Americans down towards the tail end of the field, but very close. They're still learning the way around into the S's that for the first time. Let's see if anybody overshoots. Yes, there were people going down the slip road there. One or two people not making that corner.
McElnay made up two places in half a lap. He's really trying hard, but Schwantz opening up a little bit of a lead on the ex-Tony Rutter Suzuki.
Schwantz, the leader, bike number 34, Kevin Schwantz, a really talented young man, 22 years of age, one of the youngest men, in fact, one of the two youngest men in the race. And there goes McElnay, and Burnett is on the inside, and Burnett's got the better line. So Roger Burnett goes back in front. The Rothmans on the machine ahead of the Marlboro Yamaha bike. Kevin Schwantz, the race leader, at the end of the first lap. Still there in the second place, Kenny Irons, then Steve Parrish. McElnay goes through. He goes through on the inside of Burnett. So the British men packing the places below. There is Fred Merkel, and Merkel's going very well indeed. Fred Merkel, I made in sixth place, so he's gone ahead. That is Kevin Schwantz, number 34. It looks as though Kevin Schwantz, the race leader, has gone. Parisheen, what do you make of that?
And McElnay goes to the inside, takes over the lead from Kenny Irons.
So Rob McElnay in the lead. And apparently it was Schwantz who went off at Redgate. I saw a glimpse of yellow flags. So Kevin Schwantz paid the penalty for forcing on the pace too much. And his team will have paid the penalty as well. Here's the battle for the lead. Kenny Irons battling with Rob McElnay. McElnay's got the better line. He's on the inside. But brave as you like, Kenny Irons just blocks that Yamaha across the front of McElnay's machine. And the British riders are packing the front few positions. There's only Merkel there in fifth place. Five riders close together. 23-year-old Kenny Irons, a privateer, ahead of the Works Yamaha. And McElnay drifts so close, almost touching him. Roger Burnett there in third place, number eight. That's Kenny Irons, the race leader. Number four, Rob McElnay, the British captain.
An incredible piece of riding from these two. McElnay looking for the better drive out of the corner on the inside line, but the speed of Kenny Irons' yellow Yamaha just seems to squirt him away of his team captain, and Burnett is closing up on them in third place on the Honda.
Four laps completed, three more laps to go. Kenny Irons leads for Britain. Rob McElnay is in second place. Roger Burnett is in third spot. Steve Parrish is in fourth position on the Loctite Yamaha. And behind him, the American captain, Fred Merkel. And Fred Merkel will be more than disappointed with this performance. He believes that he is a winner every time he goes out on the racetrack. And with his performances back in America, he's got every reason to be that confident. And McElnay there just cruising behind Kenny Irons. I think McElnay could go through almost any time he wanted to. And as I speak, McElnay goes through on the inside. Kenny Irons pushed back to second place. And Rob McElnay, the captain, leading at the moment. And really, if the Brits hold the positions they've got at the moment, they're going to destroy the Americans in this first race. 15 points for a win, 12 for second, 10 for third, and 8 for fourth. And that would give the British team 45 points to the best of my reckoning. 45 points, and really the Americans are struggling at the moment.
Yes, it's the Brits who are doing everything. McElnay pulling away a little bit from Irons, who's coming under increasing pressure from Burnett on the Honda. So Irons has got his sights set on McElnay, still the leader, but he's got to watch out because Burnett is going to pass him any moment now.
And Ken Irons, the man who was fastest in practice, has seen his lead snatched away by Rob McElnay. And he's under pressure from Burnett. Burnett, once again, Burnett is very, very quick at that particular part, the new section of the circuit. And that really is a bit of a surprise. Burnett through, and this time Kenny Irons will not give in. Irons has got a very quick motorcycle, and he's side by side with Burnett, but he can't hold back Burnett. Burnett on the Rothmans on the machine goes through into second place. McElnay the leader, Burnett second, Kenny Irons third. Steve Parrish
is in fourth position, and now Fred Merkel has dropped back, and let's see if we can pick up any more of the Americans. In sixth place is another British rider. In sixth place is number 33, Chris Martin. Then comes 16, Keith Ewan. Behind Keith Ewan is number 53, Dan Chivington. So the Americans in fifth and eighth place at the moment. In ninth spot is Michel Mercier, and in tenth position, Reuben McMurtough. So a bit of a disaster, particularly after Kevin Schwantz, the man who was leading the race, fell off.
And now Irons has got up behind the Honda again, and he knows that his Yamaha is faster down the straight, so he's going to try and get into the slipstream of Burnett's Honda and pull out, perhaps to pass him on the braking, but he can't do it. We drop back to see, there's McElnay leading.
So the British team at the moment pulling further and further ahead, less than a second the gap. And let's see what Barrichi sees of this race so far.
Well, I didn't actually see Kevin Schwantz go down. I just sort of caught it out of the corner of my eye. But he was going very, very hard. And I think he was a bit unfortunate because he looked very smooth. But anyhow, he threw it down the road at Redgate. I'm so impressed with Kenny Irons, the way he's going, because when you think about it, he's not on a factory bike. And McElnay, that's leading now, is on the factory Yamaha that must have sort of, I don't know, 20 or 30 horsepower more than Kenny Irons' bike. And indeed, Jibonet's on a factory bike as well. So I think Kenny Irons deserves a pat on the back.
Well, a pat on the back from Barry Sheen for Ken Irons, and a well-deserved pat on the back. 23 years of age from Luton, a winner of the Pro-Am Series. When it, in its early days, he won the 84 Pro-Am Series. Well, he's learnt an awful lot from that. He's got the bash bang rider that he was then, smooth and polished. Kenny Irons there, number 8, in third spot on the privately owned Yamaha by group captain Coulson. Splendid performance, Queen's Messenger, in fact, the man who sponsors Kenny Irons. And McElnay on the factory Yamaha, he was delighted to get this bike. McElnay, the race leader, in second place, number 9, Roger Burnett. And Burnett will be pleased with his ride as well. Kenny Irons in third spot. And Merkel, the best of the Americans, still there in fifth place. Rob McElnay, the leader, into the S's for the final time. Six and a bit left completed. He looks over his left shoulder to see where the rest is. There is number 4, McElnay. He's done a good captain's job. No complaints at all from the British supporters about this. McElnay coming round. Goddard for the final time. The checkered flag is ready. So Rob McElnay is the winner. Roger Burnett finishes in second place for Britain. Third, another British rider, Kenny Irons. Fourth, Steve Parrish. So four British riders taking the first four positions, and the first American is going to go through, and he's lost another place. In fact, it's Chris Martin that goes through, so Martin goes through, and Fred Merkel, the first Brit, is down in sixth place. Well, down in the pits, waiting to talk to Kevin Trunks, is Ganuba.
Well, Kevin, you just had to watch Britain mop up a race that you had won. What went wrong for you?
Oh, we watched the weather, and it looked like it was going to rain. It was going to stay wet, but we didn't count on the sidecars going out there. The track's almost completely dry. We put a rain on the front, intermediate on the back, and the front end just went away. It was gone after about a lap and a half.
So what actually happened at the time?
I went off into turn one, and the front end just twisted under. The front tire was probably, it's so soft that it was just rolling, and there was nothing I could do.
This weather's going to play havoc, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, and I think it was, we all made a bunch of wrong tire choices. Everybody, all the Americans out there had the same setup I had on, and we still have 7 more races. I think we can come back and do some good.
Thank you. Let's go back to Chris now.
Result of the first leg, Rob McElnay, the winner. Roger Burnett in second place. Third home, Kenny Irons. The British team looking good at the moment, but there'll be more from them. So as the grid assembles, the question is, what sort of tyre should they be using? Barry Sheen, what do you think of the selection for that match?
Well, that's a Michelin's, sort of intermediate. It's more of a wet tyre than it is an intermediate. But the compound of that tyre, that'll stay up well in these conditions. That's no problem. I think Kevin Schwantz had a problem because he plumped for a front Dunlop rain tyre, which is very soft rubber. And after three or four laps, just got too sort of chewing gummy, and he lost the front end going into red gate.
Well, let's hope that Kevin Schwantz doesn't do the same this time. They call them the starter's orders. The four-stroke engine noise rises to a crescendo. People have been pushing forward, and Kevin Schwantz is in trouble. He's waving his arm. The mechanics rush forward. Kevin Schwantz on the front row of the grid, and whatever his problem is, nobody's going to help him because the starters have said, I'm sorry, fellas, you're under starter's orders. Number one, Fred Moon there. The charge, and Ken Irons again. Kevin Schwantz made a good start, so did Keith Ewan, number 16, is there in second place. Kenny Irons, number 8, leads, and Kevin Schwantz goes through into second spot. And it'll be a brave man who winds the pair up too much. No problems this time at Redgate. Down Hollywood, into Craner Curves, and Ken Irons, the 23-year-old privateer, is the man who leads at the moment, but Kevin Schwantz is lining himself up to make the charge. There in the middle of that group was Rob McElnay, the man who won. There's the leader, number 8, Kenny Irons, 34, Kevin Schwantz. Brent leads America, and Schwantz goes through on the inside. He doesn't hang about, he doesn't wait. And that was a really fearless move for a man who took a tumble in the opening leg.
And Ken Irons said after Schwantz had crashed in the first race that when he chased the American and the American went away, he said it was like he was in a different race together, and surely he had to fall off.
Roger Bennett in second place. In third, in fourth position is Chris Martin. And there, right down towards the tail end, Ron Haslam on that basically production road bike. Kenny Irons leads from Kevin Schwantz into the S's. Then it's Roger Bennett, and Kenny Irons goes through, and he forces the American wide. Well, Kenny Irons, a hard bit of riding there.
Schwantz tried a very unusual manoeuvre to go around the outside, and this is more usual. Up the inside goes Schwantz to take the lead on the Suzuki.
Schwantz the leader. Irons on the Yamaha in second place. Roger Bennett on the Rothmans Honda in third spot. So Kevin Schwantz, the 22-year-old Texan who led the first race and then threw it away at Redgate, is going to be the race leader at the end of this opening lap. One lap gone, and there's Fred Merkel behind him, fifth place. There is Fred Merkel, you can see him. And we've got two Americans in the first five. Well, if they could finish first and second, it wouldn't do their cause any harm at all. Merkel up to fourth place now, and he's going to go around. Oh, dear, 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 dear. Well, I would have thought that Fred Merkel should have known that Redgate was slippery, Peter.
Well, certainly he does now, and he slipped so far it was down on his knee pad, sliding along on just one tyre and a knee pad, as we watch number 34, Schwantz, in the lead.
Barry, what do you think of it so far?
Well, the way Fred Merkel's riding, I'll give him another two laps, I tell you, because you just can't get away with that. Oh, I don't believe it. Yeah, I'd say one lap, actually.
Well, Fred Merkel has thrown, let's say, be kind to him and say he's thrown caution to the winds. He's in third place at the moment. We saw him have that nasty slide. The Superbike champion from America, number one, he's in third place at the moment. And he's getting that bike heeled over to not impossible angles, but brave and reckless angles considering the weather conditions. And Merkel's lining himself up for another manoeuvre here. It's Schwantz for America, Kenny Irons for Britain, then Fred Merkel, then Chris Martin, then Roger Bennett, then it's Robert McElnay, then it's Ruben McMurtough behind McMurtough, who's Dale Quarterly for the Americans. There's John Beckford. And there you are, number five, Ron Haslam, on what is really basically a road that had registration plates, indicators, and wing mirrors on when he came here on Thursday. The race leader, Schwantz, in front. Kenny Irons in second place. Merkel has lost the position. Fred Merkel has lost the place, and he wipes up the Honda. Look at Merkel now. Oh, dear, dear, dear. What are they going to do at Redgate this time? Schwantz the leader. Irons. Chris Martin. Fred Merkel, very wide, banked over, no problems this time though.
Much more circumspect from Merkel that time, but now he's round the outside of Chris Martin and then looking for the inside line, a very slippery place to try. All desperately difficult stuff from Merkel, but Martin holds the advantage from number one, the American Superbike champion.
Well, Merkel has added some spark and zest, and he just charges round the outside of Chris Martin. The question is, can he stay on here rides like this? Merkel, he was furious at his performance in the first leg.
Obviously, Merkel is one of these leaders who believes as captain you can't ask your men to do what you're not prepared to do yourself, and he certainly is sticking his neck out in pursuit of victory. Now up into third place and closing on Ken Iron. So it's Americans in first and second position now, really reversing the position of the first race.
And Kevin Schwantz beginning to stretch an advantage slightly over the British boy, Kenny Irons. Ken Irons, a Pro-Am winner, he's won the ACU 250 Production Championship, Club Championship. Rob McElnay, number four, going through. Oh, a desperate stop here between the Americans. That was Dale Quartley and Ruben McMurtry, two of the Americans absolutely side by side. Round of Melbourne, hairpin, Merkel in third place. Well, Barry Sheen was impressed with the performance of Fred Merkel, and with good reason. Here is Merkel trying so hard.
And of course, it's a mixture of machines again. It's a Suzuki leading a Yamaha and a Honda. So all three marks well presented at the front as 34 Schwantz leads 8 Ken Irons and number one Merkel, the American team captain.
I think we lost Chris Martin from that leading quintet. And perhaps Roger Marshall will not be surprised that Chris Martin has gone down, Peter.
No, the two of them had a coming together in the last race. Chris Martin and Roger Marshall collided early on in the race, and Marshall said that Chris had got in a little bit out of his depth, so I wonder if he's disappeared in this second leg.
Kevin Schwantz, the race leader. And Steve Parrish has gone into the pits. Stavros finished fourth in the opening leg. And in fact, it was Chris Martin who obviously went... in fact, we have lost Chris Martin. Just checking on the lap charts. And there's the battle for second place. Look at this. Merkel and Kenny Irons, two hard men. Oh, and Merkel goes through. Well, he thought that Kenny Irons was playing him out, I think.
Yes, Irons just got in too deep. He braked very, very late and ran wide, letting Merkel slip through.
And we're coming to Melbourne hairpin, where the yellow flags are out because there has been an incident. And it looks as though it's Chris Martin who went down. The officials are there. That is Chris Martin, the new member of the Skull Bandit Suzuki team. And the marshals being passed each side, and the yellow flags being waved. And the acknowledgement there from Kevin Schwantz. The white flag goes out. Well, Barry, it's been an hectic race so far.
Yeah, it has. There's a bit of confusion going on at the moment because the course car's out on the circuit with a blue light flashing. And I would say the most sensible thing to do would be to stop the race, actually, because Chris Martin has obviously hurt himself a bit. So the most logical thing to do would be to stop the race, because he's being attended in the middle of the racetrack, and people are tearing either one side and the other, and it's not a sensible thing to do to keep the race going, really.
And the white flags to indicate that the circuit doctor is on his way in the emergency vehicle round to the incident. And into the pits comes Ron Haslam. I know he wasn't happy at the tail end of the field. That's our production road-going VF750 Honda was quick enough, Ron thought, but he just couldn't make it go quickly around the corners.
No, it's just not wet enough for Ron to stand any chance of making use of that road-going bike.
Barry?
Yeah, it looks now as if they've stopped the race, because, as I say, the rider was in the middle of the track and the people were trying to sort of give him some help, and it was the only logical thing to do to stop the race.
And as the course cars go down, the yellow flag still being waved there, and and they appear to have moved Chris Martin, so the white flag out is there for the ambulance on the circuit. I've not seen any sign of the crossed oil and yellow flag, so I presume the race is still running. Well, Barry, what do you think about the decision not to stop the race?
Well, I was a bit confused, actually, because down at Redgate here, the guy was getting ready with the cross flags, and as I turned to talk to you, it looked like he picked them up, and then I turned around again, and the flags had gone down. But it looks now as if they've got Chris off of the circuit, so there's no need to stop the race now, but I would have thought it would have been a prudent thing to do to have stopped it earlier on.
Well, Chris Martin safely out of the way. We hope that he's not seriously hurt. Certainly the officials were there very quickly with him. Kevin Schwantz is the leader, 2 seconds the advantage between himself and Fred Merkel in second place. Kevin Schwantz the leader, there is Fred Merkel in second place. Merkel wanted to do so well. And 32 points at least for the Americans at the moment by my reckoning, and probably a few more. So that probably around 40 points, I think, for the Americans.
And of course, we can expect the Americans to get better and better through the weekend, because they had the terrible problem of learning a new circuit in very, very freezing cold, wet conditions. And now they're getting to grips with it. They're getting faster and faster, and they'll be very, very hard to beat as the weekend goes on.
So the leaders on the final lap. Kevin Schwantz, number 34, the 22-year-old Texan, and Fred Merkel, the 23-year-old Californian, the man who combines male modelling with a motorcycling career, and Kenny Irons there, he's had a fine ride, Roger Bennett. Two young British riders, in fact it's the young men from both teams, Peter, who've done the business in this second race.
Yes, if there was any lack of experience, they made up with youthful enthusiasm as we watch Ken Irons and Burnett, two of the British hopefuls here. Burnett very, very late on the brakes, making full use of the fact that the new surface is very grippy.
So Kevin Schwantz and a big, big wheelie from Fred Merkel. Third home is Kenny Irons from Britain. Fourth is Roger Burnett. And look how those boys are happy. Kevin Schwantz and Fred Merkel, they are beside themselves, and with good reason. If they can reproduce that sort of form in the three-team races tomorrow and the three-team races on Monday, the Americans could be back in it. Well, a tremendous performance, and are they happy with themselves? They are really chuffed. Kevin Schwantz, their confirmation, the winner. Fred Merkel in second place. Third, Kenny Irons from Britain. And we're waiting for the final points tally to be done, but certainly America will have done a great deal towards recouping that deficit from the opening leg. And Kevin Schwantz and Fred Merkel have definitely proved that this American versus Britain team contest is not yet over. Merkel and Schwantz punching the air in jubilation. Well, they rode like heroes, and they've got every reason to be pleased. Well, Barry, fine performance there from Kevin Schwantz and Fred Merkel.
The useful lead of 83 to 49. Barry, the Americans are obviously going to get better and better as this event wears on, but can they pull that back, do you think?
Well, I think yesterday, you see, the first race that they rode in was the first race they'd ever raced in on this circuit, and it was damp conditions. They were on intermediate tyres. Some were on intermediate, some were on full wet. For example, Kevin Schwantz, he put a full wet tyre on the front of the bike, and after two laps, it all shredded to pieces, and you saw what happened down at Redgate.
Yes.
But I think now, in the second race, they really seem to get it together and understand what it was going on. And today, with the conditions, I mean, there's no doubt when you look outside that it is raining or snowing, so they will all be on full wet tyres, and I think they'll go good.
It really is foul out there, isn't it? But they do have the superior machinery, don't they?
Well, they do, yeah, because the superbikes were sort of invented, if you like, in America, and all their bikes are specifically designed for the superbike races. But Rob McKeldy in our team, he's got an American bike, so should be a lot closer today.
A very quick word about the two stars, really, yesterday, who were Kevin Schwantz from the States and young Kenny Irons, who might not even have been riding for Britain.
Kenny Irons is a young guy. He used to ride in the Pro-Am series and that. And there was talk that he wasn't even going to be in the match races. And it's a good job he was, because he was the star yesterday. He's ridden really, really gently, and he's going good.
All right, Barry, thank you. thanks very much. More from you later. Let's now get down to the grid and join Chris Carter, because round three of the Transatlantic Challenge is about to start. Over to you, Chris.
Thanks a lot, Tony. So there they are, the competitors, and the Americans getting a taste this time of not just riding in the rain, but riding in the sleet and snow. Conditions absolutely awful. The snow, fortunately, not settling, as you can see, but things damp and very cold indeed. But at least the Americans will be in no doubt as to what tyres they should be using this time, Peter.
Yes, certainly. They'll need the full wet weather tyres, the large, chunky tread patterns that can move the water out of the way. You can see the spray coming up. It's standing on the surface. And you need the big rain grooves to move the water out of the way and let some of the rubber at least touch the surface. But it's still going to be very, very difficult. They've got to wait until the tyres get to some sort of temperature before they'll work properly. And it's a case of feeling their way over the first few laps, definitely.
So we wait and see whether the Americans can reproduce the sort of form that put them back into the contest. Certainly both Kevin Schwantz and Fred Merkel were riding with perhaps, let's say, just a little bit more enthusiasm than what the tours might like to have seen. So there is a danger they may go down on this surface. But when you look at the current top point scoring for the teams, Rob McElnay, the British captain, top scorer at the moment with 21 points. But then Kenny Irons and Roger Bennett on 20. So British riders first and second, third in the point scorers. Then Fred Merkel on 17, Kevin Schwantz on 15, Steve Parrish on 8, and then another American, Michel Mercier, or Canadian in fact, with 7, and Dan Chivington on 6. So the Americans are beginning to score points quite regularly, and not just Merkel and Schwantz.
And of course the riders have other problems other than just the road surface. You can see the amount of spray and that around on some of the cameras. Riders following other machines will have spray thrown up in their faces, and that makes it very difficult when they're slipstreaming down the straight. They also have the problem of misting up the inside of their visors when they breathe. You can see the rider there with his tape over his nose. That's so that the breeze, when he breathes out through his nose, the hot air goes down and out through the bottom of his helmet. He's got holes drilled in the front of his screen so that he gets cool air in and clears the mist.
Indeed, and there's Fred Merkel with his Arai helmet, and Arai are one of the manufacturers who've actually been able to solve this problem of misting. You remember the British Motorcycle Grand Prix last year, a lot of people in trouble with the helmets misting, and people like Spencer didn't have that problem. Arai appear to have overcome that particular worry. But there we are on the grid for the start of this third team race, the third of 8 races. And furthest away from us, again, the man who has really made a big impact on the British scene, Kenny Irons from Luton, a Pro-Am winner. He's on the far side of the grid at the moment. Then, of course, we've got Fred Merkel there doing so well for the Americans. He must be pleased with himself. In the picture there, on the Loctite Yamaha, number 6 on his helmet, is Steve Parrish. They're now beginning to pull the visors down, seconds away from the start of this third team race. No, we've got a moment of drama, moving people off the grid, and delighted to say both the Skoll Bandit Suzuki men are fighting fit. Chris Martin, who fell, and Paul Lydon are back. They've been told to watch the starters, the traffic lights. Merkel comes forward, and away they go. And it's Kevin Schwantz and Merkel side by side in the front. And there in the picture, 55, that's Paul Lydon, another British boy making a big impact. Paul Lydon, the man who leads, and 24.
That's a Ruben Mercer off onto the grass. He's desperately trying to keep the bike upright and gets back onto the tarmac, very fortunately, without falling over.
Living dangerously, but it's Paul Lydon leading, and that's the place you want to be if you can, obviously. The danger is going to go too quick, but you don't want to be in all that spray behind. Dan Chivington was in second place on bike number 53. Let's see where the other people are. There, Roger Bennett, number 9, not used to seeing him down there, and number 15, Glenn Murray, bringing up the tail end.
But it's now the two Skoll Bandit Suzukis that lead. It's Iden and Chris Martin who lead the race now.
Paul Iden and Chris Martin on the Skoll Bandit Suzukis. Both of them fell off in the second team race yesterday. Chris Martin was the man who lay on the track and caused a lot of anxious moments for people. And closing the gap now is Roger Bennett. So it certainly wasn't Roger Bennett at the back of that group. I do apologise to him. Roger Bennett and Roger Marshall on the Rothmans Honda machines. And there you can see how difficult things are. The spray billowing up. British boys
in the first four positions at the moment. And it's Chris Martin that's taken the lead momentarily from Eden. They're both side by side going through the new S's section.
And somebody overshot once again on the approach. That was Dan Chivington, who was right up with the leaders early on. So it's Chris Martin, the leader, with 33 is Chris Martin, 55 is Paul Eden. Number 9 is Roger Burnett. So Chris Martin, the motorcycle mechanic from Blackburn in Lancashire, in the Skull Bandit team for the first time. Obviously no ill effects from that tumble yesterday, and he knocked him out. He was taken to the hospital with concussion. Martin the leader at the end of lap one. Paul Eden in second place. Roger Burnett number 9, and Burnett looking for the inside line. Burnett's going to go through into second place. Burnett takes second spot from Eden, but Eden, and Roger Burnett in big trouble. Roger Burnett discovered only too well how slippery Redgate can be, and that allowed Paul Eden to go back through. Roger Marshall is in fourth spot.
And Roger Marshall has been battling all through the racing so far with terrible problems with his bike. It's been misfiring, it won't rev after a couple of laps. It seems to be working now. The team has changed everything, working up till 11 o'clock last night to sort the bike out. And hopefully number 11 in the fourth place there, Roger Marshall, finally has the machine sorted out.
And here's Ron Haslam. And Burnett through to second place then to split the Skull Bandit Suzuki's. And apparently visors steaming up is the problem for some of the riders. That's why Kevin Schwantz come in. We talked about that problem at the start of the race. There is Trevor Nation go through. Fred Merkel and Ron Haslam pressurizing the American captain. And Fred Merkel looked the wrong side for a moment, and he was lucky that Haslam didn't go through. Well, Ron wanted it to rain and snow, not for the to ruin the racing for everyone, but to actually make his bike a little bit more competitive. And there's Ron riding pillion almost with Fred Merkel.
And that is a bike you could just take out of the showroom floor that Ron Haslam is riding. Number 5, they're absolutely standard on the Just With Racing tyres fitted for the wet weather conditions. A brilliant ride, truly magnificent performance.
Well, Ron was embarrassed and angry, frustrated that he'd not got a machine that could enable him to do what he felt was his best. But he's going well now. Trevor Nation goes through in fifth place. Fred Merkel thinks they're in seventh place. Bike number 5, Ron Haslam, the local boy from Langley Mill.
Kevin Schwantz, what happened to you?
The bike quit running after I come out of the first turn. It would only run on 2 or 3 cylinders, and it'd run off and on, so I thought I'd stay out there and try it. Maybe there was just water in it or something.
Well, you had such a great day yesterday, the Americans, in the second race. You obviously can't adapt to the bad weather here.
Yeah, it's the weather has a lot to do with it, and these guys, are, you know, this is where they always ride, so they're a lot better in the weather than we are. I was, I was running third behind this two Suzukis, I believe it was, or it was Roger Burnett and Chris Martin. And come out of the corner, and it just fall on his face, so that's about all I can say.
We're back with the new race leader, Roger Burnett, holding the lead from Chris Martin. And Roger Marshall now putting the pressure in third place, getting closer, and further back down the field, Ron Haslam has gone ahead of Fred Merkel. So good news for Haslam fans, and more bad news for the Americans. And side by side, almost, Roger Marshall and Chris Martin. Now, Roger Marshall isn't the greatest fan of the world, and Chris Martin, is he, Peter?
No, it's a rather unfortunate incident yesterday where Martin touched Roger Marshall, but that's Paul Eden, I think, who's gone straight on, lost a bit of ground. So we're watching Roger Marshall chasing Martin, but it wasn't really Martin's fault, as another rider moved over and more or less pushed him into Roger Marshall. So there's the three of them now. Now Martin knows that his only chance really of winning this one is to quickly get past Burnett, because once Marshall gets past, he's really going to struggle. So if he's going to attack for the lead, it's got to be soon before Marshall can pass him. And look at that braking manoeuvre from Chris Martin, right up the inside, taking a lead out of Burnett's back, and takes the lead, moves over, takes his line. Brilliant piece of riding, but Burnett comes back underneath him, and they accelerate side by side down the straight.
And it looks as though Roger Burnett's bike is just practically quicker than Martin, but Martin has the better line on the inside. But Burnett just lobs the bike over in front of him, keeps the tight line, prevents Martin from going back through the inside, and that allows Roger Marshall to close. So we have three British riders battling not just for points but for money. Remember, £5,000 for the top point scorer, and these men all believe that they've got enough races left to claw themselves up the points table. And Chris Martin finds himself back in third spot, and you can see problems there with visibility.
It's the last lap, so it'll be interesting to see what Marshall tries here. He's going up the inside for a look, see if he can get past Burnett, an unusual place to try and pass, and he thinks better of it. It's far more likely that it will pass on one of the braking areas at the end of the lap, but there are now three braking points, the chicane and two hairpins.
Quick rundown of the leading positions, Burnett and Marshall leading, Chris Martin in third place, then Ron Haslam, then Fred Merkel, then Paul in behind Paul Lindis, Trevor Nation in seventh place, and in eighth spot is Rob McElnay, the British captain.
But both these riders now thinking about the last corners. Burnett thinking how he's going to have to cover himself from attack from Marshall. Marshall's not trying now. He's probably going to leave it until the last corner, because he knows if he passes Burnett into this hairpin coming up, the Burnett will only repass him at the last one.
So we can expect an overtaking attempt from Roger Marshall, not on this new hairpin, the Melbourne hairpin, but at Goddard, the top of this rise where the new circuit comes back onto the old section. And I think Roger Marshall is too far behind to make a serious charge. I think Burnett stretched the advantage far enough. I think Burnett is going to do it. A good ride from the young man from South Humberside. This could be Roger Burnett's year. Roger Burnett wins. Roger Marshall takes second place. We're waiting now to see who's going to go through in third spot.
And Ron Haslam takes third.
Finishes third. Passes Chris Martin, and that really is excellent news for Ron Haslam fans. He's charged through in great style in fifth, but in fourth place then Fred Merkel, who obviously followed the charge through. So let's just recap then on the result, which would likely to give the British teams 57 points and the Americans 9. Roger Burnett the winner, Roger Marshall in second place, Ron Haslam in third spot, fourth Fred Merkel, fifth is Chris Martin, sixth Paul Inton, seventh Trevor Nation, and a fine performance there from Roger Burnett, and the British team go further and further ahead.
Welcome back to Donington. Then let's just check on the score at the moment after three of the eight races. It's 141 to Britain, 57 to the USA, a long way behind there. Let's go down to the pits now, where Gary Newbon's talking to Ron Haslam, who did so magnificently to finish third in that last race on a showroom bike.
Yes, I'm wondering, that was a marvellous performance, Ron. What would you have done on a real racing bike instead of a showroom job?
I know, it was pretty hard because we couldn't get bikes, but that's the only chance I've got. If it rains, it slows everybody down, so they ain't got quite so much speed on me. And the ground clearance is not such a big problem, because in the wet, obviously, the slide earlier. As soon as you put slick tyres on it, in the dry, everything grinds and I can't get near them.
How hard was it for you?
It was very hard. The hardest thing is trying to slide it, but only a small way so you don't lose traction. Because if you slide it too far, you lose that much traction, then you start falling back. So it's mentally, it was very hard.
With this rain teeming down, have you suddenly got a chance in this competition?
Yeah, if the rain keeps up, yeah. And obviously not to start on the back row next time, I should be able to be, you know, more up the front.
Okay, well, it's a marvellous performance. I should think Barry Sheen's got something to say about that. Let's go back and join him and see what he's got to say about it.
Thank you.
Yeah, what are your observations on that race, Barry?
Well, I was full points to Ron Haslam, because when you consider how slow that bike, he should be delivering letters around London on, you know, it's just a standard bike. He rode very, very well. I was a bit surprised that the two Rogers were racing with one another. I mean, yeah, you can have
it's
a bit
good
of
for
a
spectators.
Oh, sure, it's good for the spectators, but when it gets as close as it was getting and it looked a bit hairy, you've got the chance of bringing one another off, you know, which is a bit embarrassing then, isn't it? But,
the American challenge really disappeared, didn't it?
Well, it did, because we can't exactly say how well Kevin Schwantz is going to go, because he was lying third apparently when the engine cut out. So I wouldn't write him off altogether, you know. They're quite brave, these Yanks.
Not to say a little risque.
Oh, yes, you could say that.
Especially Fred Merkel, who I think finished fifth or fourth or fifth, I'm not quite sure there, but
Yeah, I was surprised, actually, because the way he was going in the damp yesterday, I thought, I'd for sure he's going to fall down. But yeah. He obviously found out the conditions were really slippery and rode accordingly.
Just tell me, how dangerous is it out there in these conditions? Well, especially at Donington, where the water lies on the surface a bit.
It's so unpredictable. What happens, you come into a corner and you're perfectly set up for the corner, and you can just be 3 inches one way or the other and touch a slippery bit and the front end's gone. Yeah, it's very, very difficult. And on a day like this, temperatures well down, so the tyres take a long time to heat up. It's not nice conditions at all.
Not nice conditions for watching either, is it?
No.
Well, we've got the two Rogers going at it, as you were saying, a little bit dangerous.
Now, you see here, Roger lays the bike, the second Roger lays the bike down really hard to the right, and it bottoms the suspension.
Roger Marshall.
Yeah, Roger Marshall. And it's so easy then, when the suspension's bottom, to hit a bump, and it just flicks the back end out, and you'll run for the Band-Aid time.
Yes, at least it made a contest of it.
It was interesting to watch, but if I'd have been in that position, I would have been scared to death of knocking somebody off, and having to put up with all the embarrassment afterwards. But as you say, it was good fun to watch.
Roger Burnett is the leading point scorer at the moment, and he looks as if he's going to be odds on for that 5,000 prize.
Well, good luck to him. At the end of 1984, when I gave up racing, I fixed up for Roger to ride my bike, and he was my sort of tip for the top, if you like. And then last year, he didn't get very good results with Honda, because the two bikes were very different that he rode. And this year, he's used to the bikes, used to the pressure, and I think this year he'll really come into his own.
Noon from Donington, where two new stars have emerged almost overnight to turn this 1986 Shell Oil's Transatlantic Challenge into a feast of daredevil racing. You saw them in action there, Fred Merkel and Kevin Schwantz, who came over from the States as complete unknowns, but have taken this contest by storm. Merkel, the US captain, is the all-American pin-up boy, a bit part actor and male model from Balboa Island in California. He's only 23, he's the American Superbike champion, and I think now we understand why. His teammate, Kevin Schwantz, keeps a lower profile off the track, but he's tipped to become the new Kenny Roberts. The 22-year-old Texan, riding, would you believe, for the first time in Europe, doesn't seem to know the meaning of the word fear. Well, yesterday the British riders were threatening to make a complete stroll of this, and that's when Merkel and Schwantz decided they had to take the bull by the horns. Having finished first and second in race four, they thrilled the bank holiday crowd with some real heroics in race five. Take a look at this.
Into race five then of this Shell Oil's Transatlantic Challenge, and the British team now so far ahead, it's almost not true, a 90 point lead, 177 to 87. The track drying out, it has been wet, but the sun is out and there's quite a strong breeze, and that's a surprise because most of the riders other than Rob McElnay have got full wet tires on front and back. We'll talk to Peter Clifford when this race gets underway as to why most of these people should have chosen that, with the possibility, in fact the increased likelihood, of the track drying out before much longer. The normal lineup on the front row of the grid, remember that the Americans have complained about the possibilities of cheating. There's judges on each row, and away they go, and it's Steve Parrish, bike number six, and Fred Merkel, bike number one. There is Kenny Irons getting ready to Kevin Schwantz, 34, and Schwantz will be in about fourth place. Chris Martin there in second spot, and I think that was Dan Chivington who made the charge, and I don't believe he can have got that far up starting legally. We shall have to wait and see what the judges made of that. Fred Merkel is the man who leads at the moment. Kevin Schwantz has gone through into second place. Are we going to see another superstar performance from these two young Americans? Merkel leads from Schwantz, Rob McElnay, then Chris Martin, then Dan Chivington down to fifth place. Absolutely amazing. Kevin Schwantz was all but off the motorcycle. Fred Merkel was on the grass. And that is Peter Clifford.
An incredible piece of riding from Schwantz. He was right off the machine. He was just hanging on for grim death by his hands and managed to drag himself on.
Here's a replay of that amazing incident. Sam McDonald, the tail end of the field, going through. Then we're going to see Fred Merkel in a big slide,
Schwantz in trouble. Merkel on the grass. Schwantz off the bike. Look, the only thing hanging on are his two hands and one leg draped over the side of the bike. He climbs on board, cool as a light. Rob McElnay, I'm sure, just can't believe his eyes. Schwantz. What a tremendous young man he has proved to be. A fine, fine rider. So brave, so fearless, and so talented. And remember, of course, that Kevin Schwantz threw away 15 points when he crashed out after two laps in the opening team race. And here we go again, another lap completed. Schwantz the leader, McElnay and Merkel pulls out of the slipstream again, and Merkel this time makes the move, and he forces McElnay right out.
And that really was a bit over the top, I think, from Merkel. I mean, he almost had McElnay right over on the grass, and there was no necessity to do that. McElnay didn't like it at all. And it'll be interesting to see if he gives Merkel a little bit of his own medicine.
Well, Barry Sheen says that if he'd been Rob McElnay in those circumstances, he would be putting Mr. Merkel somewhere off the racetrack at some stage. Well, we should wait and see. I think both Peter Clifford and Barry Sheen are being a bit hard on Merkel. I would have said that McElnay has been moving Merkel around the racetrack a little bit as well. We shall wait and see what happens in the final stages of this dramatic fifth lap.
And the point about that was it wasn't Merkel's usual line into the corner. He's been going in there tight, and on that occasion he just went wide because he knew McElnay was coming around the outside.
McElnay in third place, quicker on the exit from that corner, right down in the slipstream. He's going to pull out of the slipstream, I think, and go for the braking. No, he's not. Schwantz leads. Merkel in second place. McElnay behind, through the S's, onto the new section of the Donington circuit, yet again. Kevin Schwantz leaves Suzuki, leaves Honda, leaves Yamaha. Well, look for McElnay accelerating harder. The intermediate should be holding up, but no. Well, whatever the rights and wrongs of that overtaking manoeuvre, Fred Merkel seems to have subdued McElnay a little bit. And Schwantz had a moment then, but McElnay appears to be slowing. Merkel chin on the tank, and Fred Merkel is leaving McElnay behind. The Americans once again having a stranglehold on this race, and they're dead level. And Merkel sliding his way around, 33 points to 33 is the situation as it stands at the moment.
And of course, McElnay knows that he's got a much more important things ahead of him. He's got a full season as a Grand Prix contender. And there's Schwantz, a huge slide. He's almost off the bike again. The back end just slid away wildly there. And he was once more half on and half off the motorcycle.
And the amazing thing is that Kevin Schwantz is loving this. He looked back to see Fred Merkel, and if we could have seen through the helmet, he would have been smiling. I guarantee it. Kevin Schwantz and Fred Merkel are loving every dangerous, heart-stopping moment of this team race, and it's mind-blowing, absolutely mind-blowing. Kevin Schwantz in the lead. He's been beyond the point of falling off at least three times in this race, and he's still leading. Fred Merkel has been grass track racing, and he's still in second place, and Rob McElnay is closing the gap. Maybe McElnay has decided that because I've written him off, I was being a bit premature. Through the S's for the last time.
Yes, and McElnay has to make the effort now. He's got two corners to do it, two hairpin turns, and he knows that he's only going to have one chance at Merkel, really. Can't do it on this corner. He's got to get a really good drive out of the turn if he's going to make any impression at the last corner, the hairpin, but he's left himself an awful lot to do.
And Merkel hanging over the right-hand side of the bike to help the acceleration. There is Kevin Schwantz, the race leader. And Kevin Schwantz. Oh, and Merkel's down. But Merkel has dropped it. He's going to get back in his feet. Schwantz wins and is delighted. Rob McElnay is going to get second place. And is Merkel going to get to restart and finish? Kevin Schwantz won that one. And once again, he punches the air. And he hangs off the bike. And he looks back to see where the rest are.
So in the words of Butch Cassidy, who are these guys? And what on earth have they got in store for us today? Gary Newbon's been talking to them down in the pits.
Fred, you've got a big reputation in the States where you're a part-time model and a part-time actor, but you've certainly made a big impression over here with the girls.
Oh, a little bit. They're really sweet and a lot of good-looking ones.
And your riding has shown a lot of personality, too. What about the grass track riding and then the crash?
Well, this is the first time I've raced in the rain in about probably a year, and I got a little ahead of myself and got a little sideways, so my only alternative was just to go on the grass. So no problem, we started back on the racetrack, and it was pretty much smooth sailing after that until I tipped over.
You do take some risks, though.
Well, all Americans, you know, we all go pretty fast, and we do whatever it takes to win.
Okay, well, let's move on to your partner, who's having a tremendous meeting as well. A lot of people are saying you're the new Kenny Roberts.
Well, I guess it's pretty good to be compared to Kenny, and Kenny's done a lot for road racing, both in the U.S. and over here, and just hope we can do the same for that.
Are you a little quieter than Fred?
Yeah, he's kind of the life of the American Superbike team. He's the go-getter. He just gets us all moving. He's the motivator.
Well, do you look quite a character the way you got back in the saddle in that fifth race? It looked like a jockey and a horse.
Yeah, I looked up and saw what Fred did, and just about the time I got it out of my mouth and went, whoa! Next thing I knew, I was hanging off the side of my bike. So I managed to keep mine off on the track and just a little bit smoother than Fred's, but glad he got back on and no problems there.
Three races to go. Here's what happened now in race six. The commentators, as usual, Chris Carter and Peter Clifford.
Kenny Irons, Steve Parrish, number six. Ron Haslam on bike number five. And Ron Haslam this evening will be catching a plane as quickly as he can off to test the El Honda out to the Paul Ricard circuit.
And bear in mind that Ron Haslam is suffering a terrible power disadvantage, even though it's wet. His bike only producing about 90-95 brake horsepower, and those in front about 125 brake horsepower. And that means that there's a top speed disadvantage of some 15 to 20 miles an hour, and it means that every time Ron opens the throttle to accelerate out of the corner, he can't accelerate as fast as the men in front of him.
And what a meeting this has been for Kenny Irons and Ron Haslam, looking for a way through. He's got past Stavridge, got past Steve Parrish. Kenny Irons with Ron Haslam in hot pursuit. This bike was absolutely in standard trim when it arrived at Donington Park on Thursday. It had got a number plate on. It still got, in fact, the road tax disc in the fairing. Kenny Irons then in fifth place with Haslam breathing down his neck, and Haslam knows every inch of this racetrack. Haslam looking for a way through. Sam McDonald, one of the Americans, is in the pits.
And it's all the more important that Ron picks really smooth lines around these corners, and he can't let the bike slide too wildly because he doesn't have the power to squirt it down the straight. You saw him run through the corner in a beautiful smooth style there. Back to Merkel, the leader.
Merkel, 6.5 seconds in front of Kevin Schwantz. Roger Burnett in third place. Then that battle between Kenny Irons, Ron Haslam and Steve Parrish. Of the fifth lap. Two more laps to go.
And interestingly, Schwantz doesn't seem to have been able to catch Merkel. Schwantz has been quicker earlier on in the weekend.
Roger Burnett in third place. We wait now for the trio of Kenny Irons, and Haslam's got in front. Ron Haslam now up into fourth position and pulling away from Kenny Irons and Steve Parrish. And then there's a real old bunch behind Steve Parrish. That's Dale Quarterly. Then it's Paul Eden, Chris Martin, Roger Marshall, and the British riders behind Dale Quarterly. Quarterly now beginning to show his pace a little bit more than he has done in the past. Roger Marshall looking for a way around the outside of Chris Martin, and not always an easy thing to do.
And it's absolutely certain that Marshall is still suffering from this mysterious engine problem that's plagued him through the weekend. He's riding the wheels off the Honda around the corners, but he really can't do anything about the speed of the other machines down the straights. The bike just will not rev. It should go to about 14,000 RPM, and it's now stopping at about 11,000.
And just a glimpse of John Ashmead, another one of the Americans we've not seen a great deal of, just behind Marshall. So this is John Ashmead's best ride. There is John Ashmead, 23-year-old, number 33, that is Chris Martin, and Martin and Marshall having a bit of a ding-dong. Behind them, John Ashmead, and it's with Disappearance of Ruben McMurtin, he puts the balance of power back with Britain. 35 to 29, the point situation in this race as it stands. Here comes this bunch. And Roger Marshall riding his socks off and not really making any impression. There is the race leader starting his final lap. Just 2.5 miles then, but Fred Merkel knows more than the rest of us that this race is not over until the chequered flag. He took a tumble at the final hairpin of the last lap of race five, and I'm sure the Californian will not want to be embarrassed in that fashion again. Merkel leads a comfortable margin over Kevin Schwantz. So again, the two Americans showing what supreme skill and ability they have, with a fine performance from the British back, who again dominating the affair.
And you can see that Merkel is riding a lot more smoothly now. The pressure is off him, he's got a handy lead, and he does know how to put a smooth, neat performance in, not at all as ragged as he was in the last couple of races.
Fred Merkel then, and Roger Marshall in fact has pulled into the pit, so whatever the problem was, Roger decided that it's not worthwhile carrying on. Two more races still to go, of course, in the Shell Oils Transatlantic Challenge. And there is Merkel about to lap somebody. Just the extension, just over half a mile to go to the chequered flag. And Merkel, very much one of the stars of the show, about to catch Neil Robinson, the young Ulsterman, one of the British men, who's not really had the greatest of transatlantic challenges.
And Robinson actually missed the start of the race, and he rejoined the race when it was a half a lap old, so it's not really surprising that he's been lapped on this occasion.
So Merkel, he can afford to follow Robinson around, he doesn't need to dodge him. He's going to get the chequered flag, watch for the wheelie. Here we go, the victory wheelie from Fred Merkel. In the fist, he's pleased again. They are delighted to win, and that's great. There's another wheelie from Kevin Schwantz in second place, and it should be Roger Bennett, and there is Merkel celebrating. Roger Bennett takes third place, holds the overall points lead. So there we are, the result of this sixth leg. Fred Merkel, the American captain, the winner. Kevin Schwantz.
Going into race seven, the penultimate, you remember, was 256 to 140 in Britain's favour. But the big question was, who could live with the Americans who'd won four out of the six races so far? We're just going to join our commentators, Chris Carter and Peter Clifford.
So the riders on the grid, and the news is that Ron Haslam will be riding Roger Marshall's Rothmans Honda machine. Marshall injured in an earlier spill, and that means that Haslam has at last a competitive bike. The British team, of course, are pulling further and further away in the points table, 256 against 140. The same grid positions as they've had since the practice sessions. That means that Paul Inton is closest to us. Fred Merkel, Steve Parrish. On the far side of the grid is Kenny Irons. All eyes on the traffic lights, and away they go on the Shell Oils Transatlantic Challenge. Seventh leg. And looking to see Merkel there. Kenny Irons on the extreme right of the picture, and it's going to be Kevin Schwantz and Kenny Irons. So America with Fred Merkel on the inside, and he's going to try and cut through on the inside to join Schwantz, but Kenny Irons holds him off. It's Kevin Schwantz, the leader. Schwantz, the leader. This is the view that Roger Bennett sees as he carves his way through on the inside of one of the riders. But he loses a position to Rob McElnay on the Marlboro Yamaha. The camera mounted on Roger Bennett, Rothmans Honda machine, out on the first lap of this, the seventh team race between Britain and America. There's no way the Americans can possibly win this contest, but certainly they've been absolutely superb. The Americans have been superb in defeat. And the news is that Chris Martin, one of the British boys on the Skull Bandit Suzuki, is already out of this race after less than a lap. Back now from our cameras watching the action from the side of the track as Kevin Schwantz leads from Fred Merkel and 29. That's Sam McDonald, one of the Americans. He's out of the action. Kenny Irons, Rob McElnay, Michel Mercier, another name up in the leading bunch. And it's desperate stuff as they go through the S's, and Fred Merkel looking for a way through. And people finding that it's very slippery out there. Kevin Schwantz and Merkel, though, having no problems as they come round Goddard's on to the old section of the circuit, winding the power on. It's the end of the first lap. Schwantz the leader, Fred Merkel in second place. Americans first and second. Behind is Kenny Irons for Britain and Rob McElnay. Then comes Roger Burnett, waiting to see where Ron Haslam is. And of course, Haslam has not had a chance to learn his way round on this particular motorcycle. And into the pits comes Graham McGregor. We're back with the leaders on this second lap. Kevin Schwantz the leader, Fred Merkel in second place.
Very, very tricky conditions here because there are drying patches of road, but it's still damp a lot of the way around, and these guys will not be using their full wet weather tyres, but will be either on slicks or cut slicks, intermediate tyres, and this makes it difficult for them because when they run across the wet patches, it's very slippery.
And there are the two leaders, Rob McElnay, and now up into third place, Kenny Irons. And you can see to the naked eye that McElnay is getting closer.
And Schwantz's bike seems to be squirming around a lot. I wonder if he's made a wrong choice of tyre. Perhaps he's got wet tyre or too soft a compound, and it's starting, the tyres may be starting to overheat.
Schwantz in front, Merkel in second place. These two Americans have been a real revelation to British fans this weekend in the Shell Oils Transatlantic Challenge. Rob McElnay, in comparison, has been almost subdued. McElnay had scored only 36 points from his 16 races prior to this race, and that isn't really the sort of form we expected from the British captain. Schwantz in the lead, Merkel second. There's McElnay in the picture.
And as the track is drying out and becoming more predictable, the loose and wild antics that these two displayed in earlier races seem to have largely disappeared at the moment anyway. Riding much more controlled manner.
Well, it'll be interesting to see how Merkel and Schwantz attack the situation when they're under pressure from McElnay. Kevin Schwantz the leader, Fred Merkel second, then Rob McElnay, then Kenny Irons in fourth place, Michel Mercier, the French-Canadian, in fifth spot, in sixth spot, Steve Parrish. Seventh is number 53, which is Dan Chivington, and in eighth spot is number five, Ron Haslam. So Haslam moving up through the field, 16th on the opening lap. And Steve Parrish passes Michel Mercier to regain a place and score more points for his team. Mercier is a man who's improved, and really we've now got a difficult situation because we hear that it's pouring with rain on the other side of the circuit, and that really is not a nice thing to find when you go storming into a corner.
No, it's really the very, very worst conditions. You have no way of knowing what's happening. You just arrive at the corner and suddenly the road that was dry last lap is soaking wet, and they are the worst possible things you can imagine.
There is Kenny Irons just coming out of the picture, and Steve Parrish under pressure from Michel Mercier, number 61. Here is the race leader. Now he's going to find this wet track very shortly, and he found it. But he doesn't ease off at all. I mean, I don't know what you've got to do to Kevin Schwantz to frighten him. We saw those incidents in yesterday's race when he was off the bike near as damaged, and Schwantz just doesn't, nothing phases this young man. Kevin Schwantz, the leader, he now knows that the track is wet, and he's gonna, I don't know what he's gonna do, but he's gonna ignore a slide like that, Peter, that's what he's gonna do.
Yes, it doesn't seem to worry him at all. He's got the rain pouring down on his visor now, he knows it's raining, and yet he still keeps the power on, the back end slides, it doesn't upset him in the slightest.
Into the S.
Old adage, I suppose, that you can't beat a confident man, and if there's one thing it is, this man is very, very confident. Confident
well,
in his own ability.
He's got every reason to be confident. He has come over here and take this competition by the scruff of the neck. America would win this leg 36 points to 30 if they keep the positions they have at the moment. The sun comes out over the start and finish straight, but the track is still going to be wet and difficult. Round Goddard's, another lap almost completed by Kevin Schwantz. This is the last lap, and the challenge from Rob McElnay has faded. No sign yet. There it comes, McElnay. They've pulled away from him without a shadow of a doubt. And Kevin Schwantz and Fred Merkel. And this is going to put some pressure on Roger Burnett. Try and check where Burnett is at the moment. In fact, he's not in the running. And that, of course, means that Burnett won't score any points to add to his tally. And I think Kevin Schwantz is not only going to win more races than anyone else, he's going to go home with a £5,000 for overall top scorer. This is Fred Merkel in second place. And just watch the celebrations from this pair at the end of this race. They love to race, but more than love to race, they love to win. Merkel looks over his shoulder and sees that the threat from McElnay has evaporated.
Very, very good riding from Merkel, because he's run a captain's race, certainly. He's seen Schwantz as a little bit quicker, maybe his machine's a little bit quicker, and he hasn't gone desperately all out to win. He's accepted the fact that it's much better for the team that they finish first and second.
No, it is impressive, Merkel's performance. I think even he would be prepared to admit that he does have quite a considerable ego, but that ego doesn't require him to have to win all the races. Melbourne hairpin, the climb up the hill, and the Americans look as though they're going to win this particular race and once again take first and second place, and maybe win it on points as well. So Kevin Schwantz, a big wheelie from Schwantz, another victory, second Fred Merkel, a king size wheelie again, and they're well, they're relatively subdued this time. Schwantz gives the victory sign to the fans as he goes round the circuit, punches the air in celebration. Third place, Rob McElnay. Line up as before on the front row of the grid, closest to us, Paul Idden. Furthest away from us, Kenny Irons, and both of these young men have done particularly well in the Transatlantic Challenge for Britain. And Kevin Schwantz is there, and so too is Fred Merkel for Britain, and sandwiched in the middle of the five-man lineup, Steve Parrish with the Loctite Yamaha. The men we have to watch for, of course, Kevin Schwantz, bike number 34, Roger Burnett, the British boy, on the Rothmans Honda, bike number 9, and Fred Merkel, bike number 1. They're the three men who can get to the £5,000 for the overall top scorer. It's a seven-lap race once again. This, the final round of the Shell Oils Transatlantic Challenge for 1986. The engine roar. They creep forward, they're looking at the traffic light start, and away they go. And Kenny Irons and Fred Merkel, bikes numbers 8 and 1, lead the charge. And we're going to see the view from Kevin Schwantz's camera bike. There is Kevin Schwantz behind, this is Roger Burnett behind Fred Merkel. Roger Burnett's Honda with the camera bike. And there is Merkel, there is Ken Irons. So Merkel leads, Ken Irons is second. Roger Burnett third, and Burnett goes through on the inside. You can see that as they go down Craner curves. And so Roger Burnett in with a fighting chance to grab overall victory. It's going to be a close fourth thing. I was looking to see where Kevin Schwantz was.
I think Schwantz just moved up into fourth place there, coming from a bit of a slow start, but it's Merkel leads from Burnett, Irons, Schwantz, yes, up into fourth and already challenging Irons for third.
So, Merkel, the race leader, and a bit of bunching there, desperate stuff, and bikes sliding, and really it's not a place for the faint-hearted out there. Merkel, the race leader, Roger Burnett, number nine. Then it's Kevin Schwantz up into third place. Kenny Irons push back. Steve Parrish, there was the distinctive livery of the red and white Marlboro Yamaha ridden by Rob McElnay. Merkel peels off for the Essers. Merkel the leader, Roger Burnett in second place, Kevin Schwantz is third, then Kenny Irons, then Steve Parrish, then it was Chris Martin well up again. Well, Chris Martin's had an eventful transatlantic challenge. Look at the lead though, Merkel has already opened on this opening lap. The pack winding their way round the Melbourne hairpin. It's a long sweeping hairpin, but there seems to be only one basic racing line on that corner. And here comes the race leader, the American captain, 23-year-old Californian, Fred Merkel. Merkel, the race leader. Roger Burnett in second place. And Merkel banking that bike over quite remarkably through Hollywood, down into Crane Curve. And Merkel is setting a very, very hard pace indeed. 3 seconds the gap at the end of that lap.
Yes, and the one British thing about Merkel's lead here is that he's on Dunlop tyres. The British tyres have absolutely dominated this event in very, very difficult conditions. And the first three bikes, that's Merkel, Burnett and Schwantz, all on Dunlops at the moment.
Fred Merkel on the American Honda machine, not his number one bike. He's left that behind in the United States, but still a very competitive motorcycle nonetheless. Merkel in front. At the moment, Merkel on 64. If he gets 15 here, that would put him on 79. And Merkel is destroying the opposition. And Merkel doing close on, I would say, 140 miles an hour along that back straight, Peter.
Yes, it's a short straight now, but it's still possible for them to get up to 140. We watch Schwantz closing on Burnett. They're now slow to about 40 miles an hour, 30, 40 miles an hour through there, accelerating up through the gears, still hitting about 100 miles an hour in that short straight before braking for a very, very tight right-hand hairpin. Burnett now screws on the power, the back tyre spins as they accelerate, going up 70, 90 miles an hour, probably up the hill, before braking very, very hard again for the 30 or 40 miles an hour around this tight hairpin. Then another burst of speed. Now the Donington Park circuit has been changed a great deal. It's no longer all sweeping curves, and it's a lot of braking and acceleration.
Merkel, the race leader. Roger Burnett in second place. Peeling hard, hard right all the way through Redgate and then Hollywood, and then the downhill plunge to Crane and Curve.
Yes, and this sweep, they're sweeping across the soaking wet tarmac now and still doing about 110, 120 miles an hour as they drop down the hill.
Into the old hairpin. On the STC Suzuki into the pits, and so too is John Ashby, one of the Americans. So each team loses a rider. There is Roger Burnett out on the racetrack, and this is what it looks like on Roger Burnett's Rothmans Honda machine, charging through the spray and the rain into McLean's, on towards Coppice, and then the charge down the back straight underneath the Dunlop Bridge, changing down through the gearbox and into the S's.
Yes, they're up now. Fastest part of the circuit, as we were saying, about 140 miles an hour before hitting the brakes really hard. And Ron Haslam coming into our picture at the back there. That's number nine, Burnett, leading Schwantz, but Haslam on the standard road bike. carving his way through the field.
And here is Ron Haslam, and that will be a sight to gladden the hearts of thousands of his fans here at Donington Park, and thousands more watching it at home on television. Ron Haslam, one of the finest riders in the sport, and one of the most popular with the British enthusiasts. Haslam in fourth place. This is when that roaster machine loses or is less competitive, and Kevin Schwantz goes up into second place, and there it is. That's the gap between Roger Bennett and Kevin Schwantz. And Schwantz powers on, pulling away a little bit from Bennett on the Suzuki. Schwantz there in second place, Roger Bennett in third spot. The gap between Merkel and this battle for second place now over 10 seconds. And Bennett will miss out on the overall first place unless he can get ahead of Schwantz and Merkel. But of course, Roger took a tumble in race 7, and he certainly won't want to do anything foolish in this particular race. Better to finish the race and lose a little bit of prize money.
And here's another example, as we're talking about racing improving the beam. That's the old VF750 Honda, but much modified with the Formula 1 engine. Ron Haslam is now gaining on this bike with the standard road bike that has replaced it in this year's Honda lineup. So that's the standard new machine gaining on the old racer.
And here comes Ron Haslam. I can assure you that Roger Bennett will be somewhat embarrassed if Ron Haslam gets past him. Haslam, he knows his way around the Donington Park circuit. He is a very, very talented rider. And Roger Bennett looks over his shoulder, and Haslam goes past, but they're both sprinting down for the hairpin. But Haslam has the better line. He's going to hold off Bennett and move through into third place. And there you see the view from Burnett's machine. Once again, the water being thrown upon the lens of the camera. There is Burnett behind Ron Haslam.
And you can see Haslam accelerate away from Burnett coming out of the corner there. That wasn't because the bike has more power. It certainly hasn't. But it was Haslam beautifully smooth riding style, making use of the smooth power delivery of this production machine to get the power on early and pull away from the corner.
Ron Haslam then in third place in pursuit of Kevin Schwantz. And as I say, Ron Haslam will be rushing away to go testing on the Elf Grand Prix bike before returning to Race in Britain next weekend at Campbell Park against Burnett and Marshall. Schwantz will take the £5,000 for the best point scorer, but Ron Haslam has got him in his sights, and Haslam is chasing. 29 years of age, from Langley Mill in Nottinghamshire, just up the road. His wife Anne and little boy Leon here at the circuit to watch Danny in action, and what a fine performance Haslam has put up all over the weekend. What a pity, perhaps he didn't have a more competitive machine at the start of it all, Peter.
Yes, and of course we've talked a lot about the speed of his road bike and the fact that it doesn't have the power of the other machines. There are other problems too. It can't accept the wide wheels for the really good tyres, and it doesn't have the same suspension as the racing bikes, because it has suspension that's designed to cope with the big bumps and everyday riding, and of course that makes life a lot more difficult for Ron.
Kevin Schwantz, and it looks as though Schwantz is hanging onto this lead 3.6 seconds, and that's asking an awful lot for anyone to do, even Ron Haslam.
Yes, presumably Schwantz has got the message from his pit that Ron was closing rapidly and has now opened up the throttle of the Yoshimura Suzuki and using its power to keep his advantage.
There is Ron Haslam, he's in third place at the moment. Fred Merkel still out in front. Kevin Schwantz in second place. Kevin Schwantz would get 84 points if Schwantz hangs on to second place. Haslam goes through. Here is Roger Burnett. He's had a magnificent weekend. He must be very pleased with himself, and so do. And there is the view from Roger Burnett's machine, changing down through the gearbox. Deville over hard left to go through the S's onto the new section of the Atlantic Park circuit. And Burnett still trying very hard indeed. Race leader Fred Merkel about to start his last lap. Behind him, of course, Kevin Schwantz, third at the moment, is Ron Haslam. Fourth position, it is Roger Burnett, of course. And in fifth place is Michel Mercier, that's the French-Canadian. That's a good performance from him. In sixth spot is number 55, Paul Itt. And in seventh place is number four, Rob McElnay, the British captain. But really, Merkel is having a remarkable performance. Merkel then on the way to victory, but he won't pick up the £5,000. That will go to Kevin Schwantz, who will have scored 84 points. Merkel will have scored 79. And they really have got the bulk of their scores from Schwantz and Merkel. What a pity, Peter, that the rest of the American team haven't quite matched up this pair.
Yes, it's an amazing thing, isn't it? The Americans produce these superstars, and yet they don't have the strength in depth. And two men have proved themselves this weekend to be some of the best riders in the world, and yet they haven't got the fellow competitors to help them to an overall team victory. And you can see Merkel there wiping his visor with the back of his glove just to keep the rain off it.
I think we must be fair to the Americans, though. This is a new track for them. All of them are coming to England for the very first time. It has been cold here at Donington. We've had snow. Here is Merkel on the way to victory in this final team race. Merkel and Schwantz have been the stars, and Merkel heads for another win for the Americans. The checkered flag goes out. There will be a wheelie. There goes Fred Merkel. He acknowledges the checkered flag, punches the air in delight. We wait to see the second and third people. Look at Merkel. Is he a happy little Californian? And a wheelie from Kevin Schwantz. And Schwantz, too, delighted with his performance, with good reason. Ron Haslam goes through, and a big cheer from the supporters here. And here is Roger Burnett. And Burnett misses a gear. And there is Merkel. What a showman. He is happy, really pleased with himself. Well, Fred Merkel, the winner, Kevin Schwantz in second place. Going back to the American performance, Peter, I think people like Ruben McMurtry have been up there. Michel Mercier has done well. I think there have been enough impressive performances to show that next year things could be very different indeed.
Yes, you're dead right. They did learn this circuit in the most difficult conditions, and at various times each of them showed what they could possibly do with more practice. Yes, you're right. Next year they come back, they'll know what to expect. They'll know what lousy weather we can have at Easter, and they should be more prepared and more able to put on a solid team performance. And led with men like this, we could be in for a beating.
Yes, and we've talked a lot about Kevin Schwantz and Fred Merkel, quite rightly, they have been superstars. But let's talk about men like Kenny Irons from the British team and Roger Burnett. There we are, dual wheelers. What showmen these two characters are. But let's talk about the English people. Kenny Irons and Roger Burnett in particular have been good.
Yes, sir, Roger Bennett has shown that he can win races this weekend on the 500 Honda and the 750. He can ride either machine. And obviously he's got the backing of Honda, and he's well on his way to progressing to be a Grand Prix star, and he'll ride in Grand Prix this year. What I'd really love to see is Ken Irons get the same sort of help from somebody so that he can make the same sort of logical progression.
Well, I think that would be nice to see Merkel once again on the footrest of the Honda. Surely. Still beside himself with delight and happiness. So the American team absolutely thrashing. There goes Fred Merkel putting up the one finger. We're number one, says Fred Merkel. Well, he really has come over somewhat unknown, but they've emerged them with tremendous credit. The result then just confirmation of the result of this final race. There, Fred Merkel, the winner of this eighth leg of the Shallows Transatlantic Challenge, second Kevin Schwantz, and third, well, the local boy, the local hero, Ron Haslam, on what is basically a production road-going Honda. So the British team absolutely thrashing the hide off the American team, but nobody really from the British unable to match Merkel or Schwantz, and that is a bit of a shame.
The biggest disappointment to me was, of course, Rob McElnay, who perhaps didn't have the machinery that it looked like before the race started.
So, a tremendous performance from Kevin Schwantz, and Schwantz comes off, and so too does Fred Merkel. So, down to the pits. In fact, we've got not time at the moment. In fact, a word from Tony Francis and Barry Sheen.
Yes, happily. Glad you could join us, Chris. I'm just wondering, Barry, you know, we thrashed the pants off the Americans, and yet nobody could live with these two guys who won. Does it seem slightly unfair, perhaps, that the winners and the second place blokes don't get more points?
No, I don't think so. I think the front two runners, Merkel and Schwantz, were so good, they deserved all the points they got.
But still, their side got very heavily beaten, didn't they?
Yeah, I think that's what it is. You've got two of the top runners on superbikes in America, and they just showed why they're the top runners. You know, they just cleared off from the rest of the guys. But I think now, when they come back again next year, the guys that were lower down the field would have had more experience. Some of them, it's the first time they've ever been outside the States. So they'll come back and they'll be more prepared. They'll bring thermal underpants and thermal gloves and God knows what.
Actually, Merkel was riding in thermal underwear. He'd cottoned onto that very early on. A quick word about Roger Bennett, because you helped to bring him on. How much better can he get?
I think he'll improve tremendously this year. He started off the season in fine style, and I think if he gets an out-and-out factory bike now and they put him in the World Championships now, he could be the next British World Champion.
I think Gary Newbon is down in the pits, isn't he, and talking to somebody? Yes, it looks as if he's down there.
Fred, it's been a fantastic performance by you two, but you must be disappointed the rest of the team haven't been able to keep you in the match.
Yeah, it's a little tough. We thought we had enough guys come over here and really help us win overall, but we had a good time. Me and Kevin, we carried a lot of the load, and Kevin had four wins, I had two, and we each had a crash, but it was a lot of fun, and I can't wait to come back next year.
How have you been able to cope with the weather? Because you're not used to this sort of weather back in the States.
Well, by now, after these 3 days, I've raced more in the rain than I have in my whole life, and I think we're pretty much used to it. They want to keep racing, we'll keep beating them.
You two do not take some risks, though. I mean, Barry Sheen, up in the commentary position, he used to take one or two himself, has been amazed at some of your antics and how you've been able to get away with it.
Yeah, we had quite a few problems last race yesterday. Fred and I both got off the track almost, and we just had to do the best we could. We like to win, so we go out and ride as hard as we can.
Well, you certainly provide a lot of personality in this meeting. Thank you very much indeed, and wonderful performance. Well done.
Thank you. Number
yes, one. We'll endorse that. I don't know about them coping with the weather. We've had a tough enough job up here as well. We'll be back with more motorbike racing from Mallory Park on April the 19th, the Spring Cup, so make a note in your diary. Let's leave you now with the two guys who really made this Transatlantic Challenge all their very own. Goodbye.
So there we are on the grid, and Chas Mortimer, a man who knows all about racing in the rain and the dry. He's been a very experienced man on the Grand Prix scene, just looking after his Silverstone Armstrong man, Chas Mortimer, the man in the background holding the umbrella, and Donnie McLeod, the older of the two Scots who formed the backbone of the Silverstone Armstrong squad there, 2 seconds faster in practice than anybody else. Next to him, Mick Crick, a Yorkshireman who's already started the season in fine form. Neil McKenzie, well, Neil, not the greatest fan of wet weather, teammate to Donny McLeod. Then Dave Butler, a young man from the tiny village of Stoke Golding, where they breed more road racers than most people have hot dinners. And then a young man from Lancashire, who I have great faith in, Jeff Fowler. He's good in the wet to dry. So a talented lineup on the front row of the grid.
And although the times say that McLeod was 2 seconds faster, McLeod would certainly doubt that, because he said he had some sort of ignition problems all through the tracks, and his bike has been firing all the time. So I think that racing is going to be very much closer than the 2 second advantage on the practice time would indicate. McLeod, Crick and McKenzie, we should see some real fireworks from them.
So McLeod and McKenzie. McKenzie, a man who broke lap records at something like 16 tracks, or 16 occasions last year. Very talented young man. On the second row of the grid, let's just see who we got there. 76 in the middle of your picture. That's young Carl Fogarty, a teenager from up in Lancashire. His father, George Fogarty, was a top road racer himself. 157, Ian Muir. Well, he's something like 8 seconds a lap slower than Donny McLeod was. 144, Jeff Fowler. Next to him, 175, Dave Butler. Neil McKenzie, number 3. Number 30, Mick Crick. And furthest away from us in pole position, Donny McLeod. So quite interesting, one or two people that you would have expected to be well up. On 24th position, well down the back row of the grid, Gary Nowell, and a surprise carries down there. And Kevin Maudsley, 21, we should be keeping our eyes and ears out for him. Kevin is the young man who's been drafted into the Silverstone Armstrong squad after a sensational club season. And also, I see right down, just scraping into the race, number 97, Dave Edmund Emoth from South Africa, who's found that the winter weather at Donington are far removed from South African sunshine.
Yes, Dave Edmund is one of the best young South African riders, but of course these conditions are completely foreign to him. They just don't race in this sort of temperature. I don't think they experience this sort of temperature in South Africa, which is his homeland. So he's really out of it as far as the conditions are concerned.
Now there's Dave Butler. Dave really hit the headlines last year. He's only had about 1 year's racing experience, but he's already proved himself to be a very, very talented young rider. So McLeod then in the pole position, Mick Crick next to him, Neil McKenzie, and McKenzie, I repeat, took a tumble in the rain at Brands Hatch on Good Friday, didn't hurt himself, but he obviously won't have done his confidence any good. Well, I think the last clearing of the grid to start the warm-up lap.
And of course, one of the interesting things as we see the riders go away on the warm-up lap is that the fastest, most fancied runners, McLeod and McKenzie on the Silverstone Armstrongs, are riding British-built machines. The engines may come from Austria, but all the frames and a lot of the cycle parts are built in Bolton. So that's really a British effort which is going to carry forward onto the World Championship trail and stands a very, very real chance of giving us some success. We'll have these men on the rostrum at the Grand Prix against all the work stars before the end of the season, I feel sure.
Well, the 250cc class, always one of the most competitive. You see the yellow and red striped flag there, which is the oil flag, also to indicate the track is slippery. Obviously, no oil out there, but the rain has left corner curves in a slippery condition, and the oil flag goes out there to warn competitors.
And this is called the warm-up lap. There's not an awful lot of warming up that you can do to the tyres, really, you have to get a little bit of temperature in them. But one of the main things the riders have to do now is to check out where the puddles are, if there's any standing water, which of course is a lot worse than just water lying in the grains of tarmac. And they'll be sorting out the lines, looking at where it seems most slippery and avoiding those positions.
Because of course these machines do aquaplane just as a motor car would, but of course without the four wheels to help stabilise.
Yes, certainly down the straight when you get up to 120, 130 miles an hour, if you hit a puddle of standing water there, the tyres are liable to ride up on the water and you can lose control even going down the straight.
And the leader's just coming into the S's, which is, of course, the turning off point from the old circuit onto the new. And onto the new section, which extends the Donington circuit from the 1.95 mile track that it was to 2.5 miles.
And another important thing to do at this point is psychologically the riders have to get themselves up to speed. They don't have just to warm up the tyres, they have to warm themselves up, convince themselves that they can go fast in these conditions, which are really liable to put them off when they sit on the grid.
Well, I think I should merely just convince myself that I want to be back in the caravan and not racing at all, Peter.
Yes, it's a psychological battle the guys have to face. They have to charge off the line just with a determination to attack this race at a certain speed.
Well, these are lightweight motorcycles, powerful engines, genuine out-and-out racing motorcycles, all fairly equal in performance and comparison. And it would not surprise me, Peter, to say the very least, if one or two and endurance. McLeod is, of the two Silverstone Armstrong people, the one most likely to cope with the weather better. They've been called under starters' orders. They're looking at the traffic light starts. They're pushing, and away they go. And it's young Dave Butler. Well, not so young, in fact, 24 years of age. Dave Butler was the one who led the charge, but he's lost out to Carl Fogarty. 19 years old Carl Fogarty, a teenager, is the man who's gone charging into the lead. It's very, very wet out there, and Carl Fogarty, the teenager, the son of George Fogarty, is the man who leads this 250cc race.
And already Donny McLeod up into third place going into the first corner, and he's now moved into second, so McLeod already gaining very, very quickly on Fogarty, and he now takes the lead. McLeod into the lead.
So Donny McLeod on the Silverstone Armstrong leads from Carl Fogarty. Wait to see whether we can pick up Neil McKenzie. Looks like he's in fourth position. McKenzie in fourth spot now, so the two Silverstone Armstrong people. There's Donny McLeod in the lead. Carl Fogarty in second spot. That could be Jeff Fowler there in third position.
And what McLeod will be now trying to do is paralyse the opposition. He wants to get clear of them. As we spoke before, it's possible if you're following a rider to pick up on his plate, on his speed in difficult conditions. But if McLeod can get away, get clear of them, and not allow Fogarty to chase him.
And that's Ian Muir, in fact, in third spot, 157. Number two, we just spotted there in the picture, Gary Noll, well down the field. But Gary, a very fine rider, riding Dr. Joe Ehrlich's EMC machines. So it's McLeod in the lead, Carl Fogarty in second place, Neil McKenzie going through into third spot ahead of Ian Muir. And then that looked like Ian Newton, I just saw going through the head of that group. There's number two, Gary Noll, being forced very wide. And a lot of weird and wonderful lines through the S's, Peter.
Yes, sir, certainly the guys don't seem to have sorted out these conditions over the new circuit at all. People going all over the place. But we're back with the leader, Donny McLeod, and he has things well weighed up. This is the new section of tarmac, and he'll be braking hard on this section before he gets over the white line and back onto the old circuit.
Coming around then to complete the first lap, Donny McLeod, the leader, Ian Carl Fogarty, still holding off McKenzie, and McKenzie just slots himself into second place. So the Silverstone Armstrong teams first and second, then it's Carl Fogarty. And then in third or fourth position now, I think it's Mick Crick who's beginning to charge up through the field. It is indeed Mick Crick. In fifth position was Ian Muir, and in sixth spot is Dave Butler. There is Neil McKenzie, and Mick Crick, who had some fine performances at Cadwell Park in the rain. There is Mick Crick, sponsored by Marshall Whitlam. Mick from Yorkshire, one of the products of the Marlborough Clubman series. And Mick Crick has not given up hope of forcing his way past Neil McKenzie. We're watching the battle for second and third place. Donny McLeod pulling further away. Well, these, of course, are the new bikes that Silverstone Armstrong have developed for the coming Grand Prix season, Peter.
Yes, the leading two machines are new bikes indeed. They're revised versions of what they raced last year. New frames with the latest Rotax engines. They're all new, and they're developments of last year's bikes. Better, they've got more horsepower. They're easier to work on, and all-round better machines. They've put a lot of time in the wind tunnel testing, new fairings, new front mudguards, and they're certainly proving to be an advantage.
And the battle still very much, and there you see Mick Crick in trouble. Thought about overshooting him, he was out, certainly ran into trouble off braking, and that could well have cost him any chance. Donny McLeod there, the race leader, a canny Scotsman. Well, Donny didn't have the best of seasons last year, but he started actually to do physical training, started running and swimming and all that sort of thing. And he said he's never felt fitter, never felt better. He's got a very good motorcycle, he's got a good team behind him. And these sort of results are just the way to start the season as you mean to go on. So the Silverstone Armstrong here, Johnny McLeod and Neil McKenzie are by 4 and 3 leave the 2-4 Sports 250cc race.
And McLeod,
the leader, Neil McKenzie, in second place.
And those two men having to work very hard at their concentration. McLeod's got nobody to follow. McKenzie can see his teammate in front of him.
And we've got a four-man dice in the picture now. And heading that group, I think it's 1.7 Ian Muir, but it's getting clearly desperate behind. And the man in the middle who's doing the bobbing and weaving is number 34, that's Ian Nook. Ian Muir, 1.57, is leading that group. Ian Newton is in the second place, which would in fact put him sixth. So that's the fifth, sixth, seventh and eighth we're watching.
Keith Nichols at the tail of that group looking for a way round. He's the third man. He's the number five there. That's Keith Nichols following number 175. They're both battling really hard, using a lot of different lines.
And of course Keith Nichols we saw, and Keith Nichols makes the move going through on the inside to move into seventh place. And a real charge. Keith Nichols, of course, we saw yesterday in the new Honda V4 Formula. So Keith can obviously ride racing bikes, Peter.
Yes, he can ride both sorts of machines, and he goes now to Arno. He'll take two guys in one go. Really brave manoeuvre from Nichols, but he's shut out by number 34, didn't allow him. Ian Newton shut across his nose, but Nichols gets a better line out of the corner and accelerates up the straight. A really great manoeuvre, has taken three bikes within about a quarter of a mile.
So Keith Nichols moves from the back of that group to the front to go into fifth position. And Ian Newton behind him by number 34. Ian Newton is a brave man as well, Peter.
Yeah, they're both young, unexperienced, but brave competitors. We're going to see some fireworks from both of them, because I don't think Newton's going to let Nichols get away from him.
McLeod from McKenzie. And it has actually stopped raining at the moment, and that obviously will be good news, not just for these riders, but for the team members with the final two team races to come later on this afternoon here at Donington. And the circuit, I hope, should start to dry out a little bit, Peter.
Yes, let's hope so. It's so cold that there's little chance of it actually drying towards the end of this race, which would, of course, upset the tyres. And you notice McLeod seems to have the better drive out of that corner. He got the power on earlier and got away from McKenzie a little bit. And McKenzie realises that's something he's going to have to sort out before the end of the race if he's going to pass on the last lap.
Well, McKenzie's bike seems to be sliding around a lot more than Donny's does, and whether that will have persuaded Neil to settle for second place